Parliament. The speaker today is Professor Sandeep Chakrabarty. Let me summarize a little bit his CV, and this way we can start in a few seconds. He did his PhD at Chicago University some years ago. Then he moved to Caltech to do a postdoc for a couple of years. And nowadays, he is the senior-most faculty member of the Bose National Center for Basic Sciences and head of the Indian Center for Space Physics. He's visiting the Astronomy, Cosmology, and Gravitation group this week to give a series of lectures on black holes and accretion. And he has been very kind to give this, let's say, popular talk about enough. The talk will be recorded, so if later you want to watch it again, please approach one of us and we'll give it to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alvaro. Okay, this is a talk which actually it is in the mathematics, it is in chemistry. You can have a lot of chemistry there, you can have time evolution, so some mathematics and some, there is a Big Bang also, some cosmology. And also there is a biology. So in general, this is sort of astrophysical, you know, mathematical, astrophysical chemistry kind of subject, which is a very, all possible subjects are, I have taken bits and pieces from various topics and to see how we can develop a complex set of molecules from the beginning of Big Bang, when from the Big Bang, when there was no particle. So slowly I want to show the evolution of the chemical evolution of the universe and then how possibly the life could have originated on Earth and also elsewhere in the universe. Now the first thing that they, of course, as you pointed out, that when the universe started, there was only a primordial fireball. We do not know what it is called ground plasma, it is thought to be. And today we have all the galaxies and stars and planets and above all ourselves. So everything we see around have to be made from scratch. And during the Big Bang, the temperature of the universe was supposed to be around 10 to the power 32 degree Kelvin. And after 13.7 billion years, namely today, the average temperature of the universe, the matter temperature, is only 10 degree Kelvin. So the universe has expanded and it cooled down, and it was radiation dominated, now it is matter dominated, and so on. So this thing has taken place, but the chemistry is primarily dictated by the temperature, and therefore as the temperature changed, different types of chemical reactions started happening in the universe. So we like to, we will trace this part. That is why I started my talk, actually starts with the chemistry, because it is I want to study. Many of you may know bits and pieces, or probably most of it, but just you will see that there are a lot of interesting things happened in the universe, and from nothingness, ultimately a very complex species have formed, and we are clearly the results of accidents, etc. So, n number of accidents, almost virtually infinite number of accidents, had to take place so that we are here today. So many people in the same room in the entire vast universe. I mean, the huge, at every stage, there was n number of choices were there, but then only one was chosen, and then ultimately we are where we are. Now, if it's a large factory, of course, you can say that it's a large factory, and after zillions of trials and error for a long time, so things have happened, okay. So it is not like that somebody has been and trying to do that purposefully. It's like having large number of monkeys. If they are given a typewriter for a long, long time, then they will come up with the story, with Shakespeare's poems and etc. without a problem, because some of the outputs will look like Shakespeare's sentences. So this is like we have a large factory. We are doing it for the chemical evolution is going on for a long time. So clearly things have happened and which are we look, you know, have to have made some sense, okay. So there are a lot of randomness, and out of that we are somehow organized, something has developed. Now, how big is big and how long is long? The universe is big and of course old. As you know that the universe started almost 13.7 billion years ago. And then today it is here, and the size of the universe now is around 10 to the power 28 centimeters. This is like 13.7 billion years multiplied by the velocity of light. That is roughly the size of the universe. This is a huge factory, and it has a continuous evolution of the different things going on. And the mankind is very much at end of this evolution. It is, you can see that it is written Homo erectus 1 million years ago and Homo sapiens only 0.2 million years ago. So that is the last phase we are now talking here, the complex species such as ourselves. So this is the situation, and we are somewhere sitting here, and the history of the humanoids are actually just only 6 million years old. And ultimately we are somewhere towards the end. This is the final 45 seconds out of a 24 hour period. So if the entire universe age is 24 hours, we are talking about the last 45 seconds of the evolution that we are around the complex species such as us. Now let us go back to from Big Bang, how we started and what chemical reactions must have taken place. So initially we started with the primordial fireball believed to be a quark gluon plasma. Now this quark gluon plasma, there due to pressure and then a heat, it created pions, so they are sort of together, and our cosmology is no better. So there we have this quark gluon plasma somewhere at very early in the universe, and then we have within 10 to the power minus 10 seconds of the universe, beginning of the universe, these protons and the neutrons formed. So they sort of up two up quarks and one down produce protons, and one up and two down produce neutrons. So in the meantime, the universe is expanding, it is cooling down, so time is very very critical, and the neutrons having larger mass, it was produced a little bit earlier compared to the protons, because it is required a higher temperature, let us say. So little neutrons are produced, and the protons are just subsequently produced, and after that the neutrons could not be produced because the universe became cooler. So, but today we see the periodic table, we see plenty of stuff there. So we are talking about the protons only sitting there. Now we have to produce all of them, and then the molecules and complex molecules. Within 1 second after Big Bang, the reactions, these are the reactions which are the most important reactions. Protons were taking electrons and becoming neutron and neutrino. This was going back and forth, and the temperature was sufficiently high, and similarly neutron and positron was producing proton and antineutrino. So these reactions were also going back and forth, so there is an equilibrium was produced, and the equilibrium ratio is that for every neutron there were 6 protons. So that was the time it got frozen within 1 second. But of course neutrons are not stable, neutrons start decaying. So if this was an exciting, this was clearly something very important, that neutrons, as soon as they started decaying, you have to be careful because you must trap them, otherwise you will end up with an universe which is only protons. So this neutrons started decaying, and this is a one-way process, because temperature has gone down, you can no longer produce neutrons back. So you produce protons and the electrons and antineutrino, and neutron half-life is only 615 seconds. So if you don't do anything much, all the neutrons are going to go down, go to decay. And so this is a clearly very exciting phase. And within, if you calculate everything, without further reactions to trap these neutrons, and universe would be made up of pure hydrogen. Now around 100 seconds, 100 to 200 seconds, the deuteriums, these neutrons got trapped by forming deuteriums. Okay, this is the only time where the deuteriums are produced, because they are very fragile. You know, on the stars also we cannot produce them. So the deuteriums we see, they are mostly coming from the Big Bang nucleosynthesis, and of course you can take the molecular cloud and so on, you can absorb them into other species, but you cannot produce them ab initio. So these deuteriums are produced, a little bit of neutrons, by the time equilibrium was reached, a little bit of neutrons have already decayed to some part of it. So instead of 1 out of 6, we have 1 out of 7 neutrons. Okay. So this is pretty much what we see even today. So that tells you, that is one of the reasons why Big Bang was thought to be the correct model, because this is the prediction that took place within 3 minutes, within the first 3 minutes, that's as Meinberg also wrote a book on it, that it is basically the composition got frozen, and we have for every neutron, there are 7 protons. Now what can you do with them? You can produce, keep some of the protons separate, and then some of the, you can produce helium nuclei, and for every 100 gram of the universe, you will have about 75 gram of hydrogen or proton and 25 gram of helium. So that is this thing is automatically frozen the composition of the basic composition of the universe. So around 200 seconds the heliums are produced. Deuterium again captured neutron, and these are the typical reactions which take place with to produce helium. Of course others are unstable, they will decay into other objects, or they combine immediately and ultimately you have got helium. So helium nucleus is very much bound, and these reactions will go only in the forward direction, because helium is very difficult to break into smaller. In the meantime, the temperature is going down every moment. So that was the that is how the helium and the protons. So whatever the number of protons could get into this reaction, that was the only proton which just went away and formed the helium 4, and the rest of the protons remained as they are. So we have protons and heliums. Reverse reaction is again not allowed mostly because the temperature is falling off. Now deuterium is immediately used up. As I said, it is very unstable, and you can, and they are very much, they join together and to produce other elements. And so deuterium is very little, extremely low, 10 to the power minus 5 gram per gram or something. So this is a very little deuterium. So eventually the temperature became so low that the electrostatic repulsion of the deuteriums causes the reaction to stop. So deuteriums remain as they were. They were not totally used up. It is interesting that they were not used up, because that is the only deuterium that we got today. Almost all the neutrons in the universe end up helium 4. So all the neutrons that you see went into helium 4, and the leftovers protons were there. This is the situation of the early universe within 3 minutes. So we have 1 out of 7. You have, for every 2 neutrons, you have 14 protons, and you can, if you break into 2 neutron plus 2 proton plus 12 proton, you can see that out of these you can produce 1 helium, and there are 12 protons. So every 25 gram of helium, you have 75 gram of proton. As simple as that. So the future of the entire chemical universe is frozen in just 3 minutes. The rest you will see are just the details of this thing, a little bit of here and there, but the major periodic table is only made up of hydrogen and helium. So the most interesting thing that happened, that the reason why nothing could happen after that, is if you notice the periodic table, you will see that there is a missing atomic weights. You know, there is helium with a 4, and there is a lithium which is 7. So the 5 and 6 are missing in the periodic table. And similarly, lithium has 7, and this one, beryllium, has 9. So that 8 is missing. So because these two are, there is a two important gaps in periodic table. That was the reason why Big Bang could not produce any other things. Because every time helium 4 and helium and a proton, they want to join together to produce something of atomic weight 5, there is no stable element there. And similarly, if 2 helium 4 want to join together to produce something helium atomic weight 8, there is nothing there. So all this, whatever they produce, they immediately decay back and something like that. So very quickly. So Big Bang nucleosynthesis could not make any other, a little bit of lithium, proton, and helium nuclei. So, and deuterium, of course, is an isotope. So this is the biggest problem that happened in, so whatever we see in this room or all the entire rest of the universe, all the metals beyond hydrogen and helium, we call everything else we call metal in astrophysics. So all the metals have to be produced inside the stars. and because these Big Bang nucleosynthesis could not do it. So this is what I wrote there: lack of stable nuclei limited the Big Bang to produce hydrogen and helium and a little bit of lithium. No reaction helium plus helium was thus possible. So this was the situation within 3 minutes. This is their 200 seconds. The deuterium was you can see the proton went down, neutrons were used up, neutrons were totally used up, whatever they had, 1 out of 7. And then we have some helium 4. This is helium 4. Then there is a little bit of deuterium, helium 3, and so on. But they decay immediately within few days. So they will not remain when the star was born, etc. So only thing that remained are these two, hydrogen and helium. These are the nuclei, not yet atoms. And deuterium, these are all the nuclei, some of the nuclei as well as the lithium 7 are there, but this is the only thing that we got. So when the stars were produced first, the first generation of stars, we can call it population 3, they were made up of only hydrogen and helium. So these stars did not have any metal, and even if they had some protostellar disks, they would not be producing any planets. So there is no question of producing life in the first generation of stars. Because you are not producing planets, planets required, you know, sticking together the matter, phosphate, silicate, and you require the metals, so you cannot produce planets in the first generation star. So the first generation stars were there they collapsed. They started doing nuclear reaction to produce more and more complex nuclei, and then they ultimately, either through winds or through supernova explosion, they spewed the metals out and produced the next generation molecular cloud or next generation clouds, which again collapsed and fragmented and produced the second generation star, which may now have planets. So this was therefore no question of having life or anything, let us say, in the first generation star, till they explode or they spew out their matter inside. So the next step is, of course, to produce other elements, and they must be formed in the first and second generation stars. So I mean, there are infinite number of stars virtually we see in the sky, and depending on the mass, they are burning various things. Okay. Now this is, for example, the shell structure in a massive star. You can see that the central part is, so suppose it started with hydrogen helium, and then 3 helium produced carbon plus helium produced there is a oxygen 16 neon, there is a reaction rates are different, so sequence is not always in terms of the atomic weight. And then you have the silicon, and then the iron is the most stable element in this at the center. So you have iron 4, and then if suppose this is one of the scenarios, if it's massive star, then this iron will collapse because it cannot generate nuclear reaction anymore, and this core will collapse and will produce a black hole or a neutron star, and these neutrinos which are generated out of the collapse will push the shell out and will produce a supernova. So this is the fate for a, let us say, massive star. Now, but you can have all these burning simultaneously, and the different stars will be ending up, depending on the mass, burning different things. Maybe there will be carbon star, or burning mostly producing carbons. There will be mostly producing oxygen, some stars, depending on the initial mass of the fragmented region we started producing the star. Supernova explosion is not very common, but almost every 30 years, every galaxy, we assume that the statistics says that there should be one supernova. In the 1987, almost 30 years ago, there was one supernova, this star exploded, and it was a supernova 97A. Even today, we do not know whether the central object is a black hole or a neutron star, because the shell is sufficiently thick, and people are trying hard to see what is going on inside the shell. Now, so supernovas are there. This is the Crab Nebula, another supernova which exploded, the star exploded about 1,000 years ago, and it has now become pretty big. It is spewing up, it is distributing this metal into space. So if all these supernova remnants come together, or the winds, they can produce a huge cloud again, there will be collapse and fragmentation, and a new generation of stars will be produced out of these metals. Like our solar system, second generation start, and it has all the metals. Then we see in the periodic table, the otherwise we would not be making the periodic table, we wouldn't be very much sure. Of course, some of them have to be produced in the laboratory, but mostly our solar system contain these metals. Now, if we consider this is Orion Nebula, it is of course it is upside down in this other hemisphere. But if you see, this is a cloud, let us say, this is a cloud, Orion Nebula, this is a star forming region. So molecular clouds look very pretty and they emit all these radiations, hydrogen and of course the helium lines, etc. And you can see this Orion Nebula, new stars are getting born here. Okay, new stars are getting born. They will have lot of, and all those stars which at least burn hydrogen, they will always lie on this particular sequence. This is called main sequence. Okay, ultimately after the collapse and fragmentation, the stars, depending on the initial mass, it will sit down in one of these places in this sequence. So this is how the stars mass is distributed. On this side may be 60 to 100 solar mass. This may be around 0.1 solar mass, and this is Sun sitting here, 1 solar mass, and the luminosity is 1, surface temperature is 6000. These stars are very bright, and they because they are very massive and the central temperature is very high, so they burn very quickly. So it's not like Sun is burning 4.6 billion years and it has fuel to burn another 5 billion years. But these stars have extremely hot, central temperature maybe 10 to the few times 10 to the power 8 or even 10 to the power 9, almost 100 times more than the central temperature of the Sun. So they burn much faster, the temperature sensitive, where the nuclear reactions are highly sensitive to temperature. They go like T to the power 4 or T to the power 12, even T to the power 16. So if you increase the temperature by a little bit, by even 1%, the 16% increase in the nuclear reaction rate. So in energy will be generated very rapidly here, and these stars will very quickly evolve. Within a few million years, they will evolve and they will do supernova, or various things depending on the mass. They can also lose some matter in winds, and ultimately they sort of distribute their elements. Those which are very low mass, which are not yet burning hydrogen or they may not be able to burn, they remain for a long, long time. In fact, their temperatures are very low and they are likely to be metal poor because nothing is happening inside. So if they started with hydrogen and helium, they will remain with hydrogen and helium. So the oldest possible stars will remain as they are if they are light. If they are massive, they have already done their job and they have already started producing the second generation. So of course nuclear reaction I talked about, that inside the star, there are also possibilities. People do calculus. We have done a lot of calculation when I was in Chicago. People usually take it also seriously, that when matter is falling into a black hole, the temperature also goes up by 10 to the power 9, 10 to the power 10, and you can do a lot of nuclear reaction in that process. Of course, most of the process product goes into the black hole, so no fun in making them, except that there are jets and winds which take away about 20% of matter and to the surroundings, and it also increases the metallicity of the galaxy. So the galaxy may be enriched by continuous process. The best part of black hole accretion is that almost continuously it is getting processed rather than one time shot in the case of stars. Now, so this is a nuclear reaction process, and these jets can of course distribute this metallicity into the surroundings. So if we now consider the periodic table from a molecular cloud, molecular astrophysicist or astrochemist point of view, it is mostly actually hydrogen, maybe a little bit of helium, and then others are like trace elements. Okay, this is like 73.9 gram ultimately, after all this burning with inside the stars, etc., and you have about 24 grams of helium, 73.9 grams of hydrogen, and the rest 0.1 gram or so, 1.9 gram or so in all these elements that you see. So they are basically trace elements, but without them we will not be here. So this is an estimate, for example, out of per million, we have hydrogen like 739,000, helium 240,000, oxygen 10,400, etc. Only these are the topmost. You can see that the others are trace elements compared to hydrogen and helium. Now second generation of stars are formed, and of course we can have planets. Now so far, this star formation is a long story. Before that, I want to also bring one interesting aspect that the cosmic microwave background people appreciate very much. That when the universe was cooling down at 3000 degree Kelvin, and then these electrons started sitting on the started orbiting around the protons, and a hydrogen atom was produced. So that was the first time that you started producing atoms, and then after subsequently you also produce helium atoms and lithium atoms, etc. And once you reduce the number of electrons, the photons have no way to scatter anymore, because photons usually used to do quantum scattering with electrons, because electrons are very light and you can scatter them very easily, much better than the protons. So you scatter with the electrons, you used to scatter, but just after the universe became 3000 degree Kelvin, getting cooler and cooler, all those scattering stopped, and the matter basically froze into atom and these photons, and the photons are called, it's called decoupling. So photons decoupled from the matter, and what the photon distribution that you see in the cosmic microwave background today, they basically are, they contain the impression of the matter distribution at when the universe was 380,000 years old, so at a redshift of 1100. So that is the time when after that the photons have not actually scattered with anything, because very few matter. After that the universe became transparent to them. So the photons we see today are directly coming from 380,000 years after Big Bang. And in the meantime, matter started collecting together and the gravitating and producing stars and the galaxies, etc. So these two are separated. Their tracks actually separated. So when the universe starts getting cooler, eventually all the nuclei from the respective atoms form respective atoms. This is the time when molecules will start forming, especially in pockets of cooler region. So you have to produce molecules, so you need to have the temperature very, very low so that the molecular bonds don't get disrupted. So once you bond them, otherwise they will break them again, you will break again, and they will again produce atoms. So you require deep, you require somewhere deep inside where the cosmic radiation is not entering, and some cooler pockets are there where you start producing the molecules. But so the next place for chemical revolution of the universe are the place must be molecular clouds. Okay, we call them molecular clouds assuming that all the molecules have formed, but in reality they were of course atomic clouds. And then the biggest problem was how to produce even hydrogen molecule, because you have to remember the universe is expanding very rapidly, and the mean free path is very big. And so if you have two in the gas phase, two atoms of hydrogen, it will not be easy for them to find each other, and therefore it is not easy for them to produce H2 molecule. So in the gas phase left to itself, even hydrogen molecule would not be forming. So no question of again the life formation and other things. Fortunately, what happened is that when the stars started forming, they have to remove angular momentum, because otherwise the stars would not be collapsing, and these matters which come out from the bipolar outflow started expanding, and you start producing something called dust. Okay, it's very easy, we don't like them, many people have allergies, but unless you have those dusts, you won't be able to produce even the hydrogen molecule in space. So this adiabatic expansion or something produced these dusts, and these dusts are typically of two types. One is that either they are carbon rich or they are oxygen rich. It all depends on mostly the environment where it was formed. Like if you have a carbon rich stars having lots of carbon around and very little amount of oxygen, all the oxygens will be used up to produce carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide. So oxygen is gone. You are left over with the amorphous carbon. So these are the dusts, like the soots in the kitchen, in India at least. So you have these soots in the kitchen, you don't like them, but we like them. Because on them, you produce the molecules. Now, of course, if the oxygen is more than the carbon, then again carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide are produced, and the oxygen is left over, which will be producing silicates and phosphates, etc. So typically there are two types of grains in the interstellar molecule, and they have a little bit different properties in terms of the barrier potential and how much energy you require to produce whether it is easy to hop from point to point on the side, from one side to another on the molecular surface. Okay, and once you are produced, can you easily take it out and dump into the gas phase? So there is a gas phase. 99% of the molecular cloud is gas. Only 1% is in the form of dust, in the mass. So in that situation, you produce first on the dust, and then you spew them out. You sort of when the cosmic radiation falls in, or it goes into the hot region of the hotter region relatively, it sort of these molecules escape, and so you produce them. You produce as molecule. You take them as atom and give back molecules. That was how the molecular clouds produce the molecules. Now, how big are the molecular clouds and how big are the star forming region? They could be kiloparsecs big. Okay, kiloparsecs and hundreds of kiloparsecs even. Even the small piece that you see there is much larger than the solar system. So you can produce n number of stars, and each of them will have the a solar system around each other, kind of this. Okay, because you have to do angular, there is an angular momentum. It's very difficult to get rid of. So you have angular momentum, it will be rotating round and round, and it will not be able to collapse radially on this side because of centrifugal force, but it will be collapsing on this side very easily because there is no centrifugal force along the axis. So you end up having disks around protostars, and ultimately it evolves and you produce planets on those disks. So you take these are the real pictures of by Hubble telescope. You take the Orion Nebula, for example. You take any of the star, you see the star sitting there, it's about to form. It has not yet formed. And you can see this dark region, which is cooler, and is producing a disk around it. Eventually, it is going to produce, let us say, a solar system type system. And of course, if you are not lucky, you will not be able to see your face on. You may see edge on. So the star is sitting somewhere at the center, and here in different angles. Everybody is in different angles. They're all randomly distributed. Now, this is the situation. But inside this cloud, if you take a good instrument like ALMA, and of course there are many infrared instruments, you will see hundreds of such molecular lines. Where did they come from? Okay, as I said, that is very difficult to even produce hydrogen molecule. But you can see these lines, which are very complex lines. They're flooded with lines. In fact, so many, most of them we cannot even identify the complex molecules. Now, so far 200 molecules have been discovered in different molecular clouds. Okay, and some of them, of course, very complex, like C60, C70. So it is very, you brought at least 60 carbons together for somehow. Okay, in this space, how tenuous is this space compared to this room? This room has number density of let us say atom 10 to the power 19 particles per cubic centimeter, and these molecular clouds have only 10 to the power 4 maximum, 10 to the power 4, 10 to the power 5. So it is 10 to the power 15 times tenuous, almost. So the mean free path will be 10 to the power 15 times bigger, generally speaking. Even then, you fetch these things and you collect them together, you make complex molecules, okay, because you have plenty of time. And it is a big laboratory. So how were these complex molecules were formed? These temperatures were only around 10 degree Kelvin, and the gas is hardly 410 to the power 4 particles per cc. As I said, in this room it will be like 10 to the power 19 few times. So highly tenuous. So this is almost like impossible that one atom will meet another atom at all, because mean free path is so big. The biggest problem is how to produce even the simplest molecule. I already discussed that the composition is 99% gas and 1% dust. There are all types of dust are also there. I have already given some introduction that there are two types of mostly the olivines, the oxygen rich, and the amorphous carbon, which is carbon rich. Okay. If you take it under a microscope, they look like this, and they have lots of sites on them, so that the hydrogen, if it lands on it, it will go on hopping around each other. It is easy to meet another hydrogen atom on that dust rather than in the gas phase, because it is a small dust, about a micron size. Okay, a micron size, maybe 100 sites on this side, 100 on that side, 100 on that side, 10 to the power 6 sites to 10 to the power 12 sites. It is easy to find them. Okay, and once you find them, you produce the atom molecule right there, and then leave it to gas phase. So these are the typically grains we find in interstellar medium: amorphous carbon and olivines. Now, of course, this grain is a random surface, and on which you go on, you bring these atoms and you produce something. Mostly, first you want to produce a hydrogen, and then of course hydrogen is oxygen is the next abundant, so you produce the OH radical, and then another hydrogen is very abundant, so you very quickly you produce water, and you will also see some carbon sitting there. Carbon will be hopping around, nitrogen will be sitting there, it will be hopping around, and you will be finding cyanide compounds and hydrogen cyanide, the poison. For instance, the first things that happen on these grain surfaces are water and of course hydrogen cyanide. It's very easy to produce the lighter molecules because they hop around a lot. If you produce a very heavy molecule, they will not hop around, so it is very difficult to produce even more complex things, and you just wait for a cosmic ray to knock you out from this thing and bring you to the gas phase. Okay. So this is how, so you start producing ice mantle, and ice mantle will have a lot of complex molecules started forming there, because there are cosmic rays are hitting them, so momentarily they get liquefied, and then they during that process it is very easy to react, and then when they froze again, a more complex molecule has formed. So this is the best place. The surface area is very good, and you produce more and more complex molecules. Just to give you an example, that when you start doing a reaction, doing this calculation, these are very new calculations. Like, although people started doing very simple calculations last 30-40 years ago, like to produce water and OH and carbon disulfide, carbon monoxide, etc., it is one thing. But when you want to talk about life, you have to go on, you have to end up producing adenine, guanine, cytosine, thiamine, etc. These are very complex molecules. So you have to know exactly what kind of reaction cross sections are there, whether it is likely to be produced in the interstellar space, why, and then the most important question, do you really want to produce them there, or you could have done it on the Earth itself, where the density is higher, etc. So it is not the question of whether you want to be there, to make it there. The question is whether it is produced there or not, given all these things that you started with, and given the large laboratory, long time, it will take a, so where, can you produce adenine, for example? Can you produce guanine, cytosine, or the complex biomolecules, glycine, aldehydes, sucrose, glucose, all the sugars and everything, so that you like to do, whether it's a RNA world is going to come up or a DNA world is going to come up, even from the beginning, independent of whether a planet is formed or not, or whether a star is formed or not. It is collapsing, so it should chemically evolve. That is the idea. So you start on the, let us say, on dust particles, and assume that all kinds of reactions take place on the dust particle. Of course, their chain is very big. I have just given the most important ones. And there are similarly infinite number of other reactions can take place in presence of cosmic radiation, because if there is a star formed there, that radiation will also affect the formation of molecules in this region, okay, depending on the opacity. If the opacity is intermediate, the radiation will get in and will start to, these are the reactions which are exclusively in presence of radiation, okay. So radiations also play a major role in changing the complex molecule. So main question is, therefore, can complex molecules in interstellar be produced left to themselves? Okay. So basic issue is not, we are not worried about the origin of life on Earth. We are worried about whether the complex molecules is a generic process during the star formation. This is a question, that if a star is born, matter is formed within the few million years, matter is getting collapsed, and during that evolution time, can you form complex molecules? Okay. That is the first question. Then we will worry about what happened to Earth. So where biomolecules also produced by this process, and then the how life is originated from the biomolecules. So in order to, let us say, to produce adenine, we need to again go back to the grains, because grains produced this hydrogen cyanide. And you can go on adding one after another and produce adenine, C5, H5, N5, for example. Or you can go through n number of metastable processes, then ultimately you can produce adenine. So in every stage, it is possible to verify, because there is a precursor to produce adenine, And then that if you, even if they are, I mean, see, more atoms you add, the abundance goes down, because it is hard to produce, hard to bring lot of things together into a single atom. So more and more complex atoms you form, they are, of course, the abundance, the mass fraction goes down. So so even if you cannot see them in the molecular cloud, you can look for the, just the precursor one, who produced adenine. So just the previous stage. And so if you can see them, then of course the adenine would be also will be seen if the technology is improved. Or there will be always some place where it is almost towards the last phase and the adenine abundance may be very high. So the, you start with the basically the hydrodynamic collapse of the gas, and at the same time you start doing the chemical evolution. Every second you do this calculation with about 600 species, with about 10,000 reactions, and many of the reaction rates you have to calculate yourself by quantum mechanical chemical reaction. You know, there are DFT calculations, there are a lot of methodologies by which you can calculate the pathways by which you can make a complex molecule. So in Indian Center for Space Physics, we are working on large number of pathways by which you can produce the complex molecules, calculate the reaction cross sections, putting them into the code and trying to see if complex molecules are produced. Of course, many people have started after that. We started it 2000, first time we started asking the question, can DNA molecule be produced? And we produced some molecule very low. You can see that the glycine, alanine, adenine, glycolic acid, urea, etc., 10 to the power minus 10 gram, 10 to the minus 12 gram per gram. Okay, these are so low abundance that even if we excite them, of course, you require a lot of you generally require a large amount of abundance to be able to see the line emission. But nevertheless, these complex molecules are produced for the first time, that a quantitatively one could compute. And of course, this is the system has, we have improved the situation. Glycine, this is the simplest amino acids, and acetic acid and alanine and propionic acid, etc. A lot of things, all of this could be produced significant amount. Okay, you don't have to have any planets with lives or anything. These are generically you produce while forming stars. Okay, of course you require to have about few million years to do that. If it is too much massive star, it collapses very rapidly, maybe 50,000 years, you won't be able to produce this. So let us say 10 around 10 or 3 solar mass downward, you will have sufficient time to produce them. So that is also an interesting thing. So generically many star formation processes already include formation of complex molecules even before the planets are formed. Okay, this is a generic result. There is nothing wrong in that, and there is nothing to be surprised about. But how do we know that these are produced? Because we know it, because we know that when you take a meteorite which is coming from space, deep inside the meteorite, if you do the analysis, you find deep, very complex amino acids. And these meteorites are the leftovers, are produced by the leftovers of matter which could not produce planets or satellites. So these meteorites, in that frigid condition, in that very tenuous condition, did manage to produce, these meteorites were produced in the gas region where at least these complex molecules are produced. Many of these amino acids are not even seen on Earth. So these complex molecules are formed in Murchison meteorite as well as in Allender meteorite. Both of them contain large amount of such complex. Yes, we have not seen them directly in the gas phase, but in the solid phase, we know them, they know that they exist, and they have to be produced in the same process. And so they have to be, so wherever the radius where they are produced during the, let us say, during the collapse phase, Earth was at some radius, let us say around one astronomical unit away, and then meteorites may be in the Mars orbit or intermediate somewhere they are produced. So clearly these amino acids were produced there, and so these amino acids were, these were born, these were formed out of those amino acids, among other things. And then they smuggled them, these things, deep inside their core and went away to, let us say, due to angular momentum, because they also carried large amount of angular momentum and stayed away, and then started coming back again and again and losing angular momentum due to interaction, many body interaction. So when the earth was very early on, so the fact is that it is certain that many amino acids are formed in space. So far amino acids have not been seen in direct observation of clouds, but it is technologically also very difficult because typically abundance is 10 to the minus 13 gram and it is very difficult to excite to a very strong line out of a very small abundance. Your radiation has to be focused onto that molecule only to be able to excite all of them which exist, and they are all dispersed. The abundance is so low. So we are getting there, but the things are getting there. Precursors have also already been discovered. One can of course observe the precursor of amino acids, and then the efforts are on to produce the amino acids. In fact, the glycine, half of the people said they have observed glycine half in the gas phase, and half of the people did not see, said no, it is a dicey, maybe it is some error by student. So this is the situation to produce the complex molecules. Now, first of all, we know that we understand one thing, that okay, although it takes a few million years to produce them, and so what is so flaming hurry? Why couldn't you do that on the Earth itself? First of all, if you see the Earth is around again 4.6 billion years old, and there are stromatolites which are like microfossils and clay. These are all in Australian somewhere, microfossils around. These are at least 3.7 billion years old. So very early on, already complex, already monocellular species have already been formed. Okay, so there is a hurry. You have to hurry to produce them, because you have very little time, 0.9 billion years. Out of them, there is a huge amount of time when it was hot and hostile situation, and it was getting continuously bombarded by the meteorites, which are leftovers. Right now, we are not getting bombarded very much because Jupiter and Saturn are pulling them away, because they are massive objects in our solar system, and the numbers have also gone down. But during that time, almost everybody had their share, and the Earth was also having large amount of bombardments. And those which immediately got bombarded, and probably also all these amino acids got destroyed, yeah, very early on. But these meteorites did one good thing: they brought a lot of water. And so all the water that you see on Earth has been brought by meteorites. So if the meteorites can bring this water, they might as well bring these amino acids also, when this Earth got a little bit cooler, less than 100 degrees centigrade. So that if the water remains settled in liquid phase, and then why not other amino acids, okay? And then you got a huge ocean, and ocean currents are there, the tidal forces of the sun and the moon. This is a big star, like a chemistry laboratory, with the tidal waves going back and forth. This huge laboratory which is starting and producing more and more complex molecules on the ocean. So basic ingredient is actually, we believe that they have come, Earth could jump start making the complex molecules by borrowing them from the meteorites, and then proceed. How it could proceed? Because this temperature was roughly interesting place. This is called a habitable zone where the Earth is located. The others could not do it, but others got their share also, bombardment. So these all these things, when they bombarded the Earth, as I said, that the ocean was produced, as well as the amino acids and other things, ingredients of life were also brought in, urea and all these glucose, sucrose, etc. In other stellar system, of course, therefore it should be there, because it is a generic method, and we are sitting in a generic planet, around a generic star, in a generic galaxy, so there is nothing particular about us. So this methodology that life should be formed, at least the basic ingredients should be supplied to the planet, and ultimately whether the planet will develop a life or not, depends on whether it is residing in a habitable zone. Okay, what is habitable zone? Okay, typically if the sun, let us say, the one astronomical unit, the temperature is around such that you can see that what we mean by habitable zone. The first of all, this habitable zone is such that at least one hydride can stay in liquid phase, gas phase, and of course all the three phases: liquid, solid, and gas. Okay, water. We have ice, gas. Water vapor, as well as liquid ocean is sitting. So we have the hydride of oxygen, namely water, can stay in three phases. So we are very happy, and we know that the life could develop from there. It is also just like grain case, so solid water is also very good in making complex molecules, because it can dissolve lot of interesting things, lot of chemicals, and then let them we have reactions in the liquid phase. Liquid phase reaction is often very fast. So if the water were not produced, we would not be able to see complex molecules coming up. Of course, they also save them from hostile gamma rays, etc. in the early earth had, because gamma rays will again break the bonds and break in the molecules. So water is needed. Of course, people are also looking for the hydrides of carbon, namely methane, and hydrides of nitrogen, namely ammonia. So wherever you look for the people are talking about Europa and Titan and all these places, they are looking for amino acids. So obviously ammonia would be good, but not too much water, please, because then the ammonia will be dissolved there, and you cannot produce the amino acids. It is the similar thing that happened to Uri Miller's experiment 1950s, that he started with a lot of nitrogen, hydrogen, etc., and also ammonia. But they, and then amino acids were produced when you constantly do this sparking. But proto-Earth did not have these ingredients. Proto-Earth did not have this ammonia, because then if ammonia is there, it will be dissolving into the water immediately. So it will be taking, you can take the ammonia out of the atmosphere very quickly. So that was a problem with why you don't have, first of all, you don't have to produce them on Earth, and and the method that was used was probably not correct. Now, in any case, as the star gets bigger and bigger, the habitable zone just goes away from the star, just to keep the temperature so that you have the right set of conditions. So now there is one famous Drake equation. Nobody knows how you are allowed to add some more stuffs there, because all it says is that if you want to do, this just gives you an idea of how to calculate the number of planets where there are intelligent life from. Okay. Just an idea, but there could be some other ideas also. We can continue. This is the total number of, let us say he wanted to calculate something, that all of them are less than one. Okay. And so he wanted to know how many, what is the probability that you can have intelligent life in a galaxy. Okay. So R is the average rate of star formation, and a fraction of good stars that have produced planetary systems, number of planets around them within an ecocell or a habitable zone, fraction of those planets where life develops, fraction of the living species that develop intelligence, fraction of intelligent species with communication technology, and lifetime of the communicative phase. This is important, because suppose that 100 years ago we didn't have any radio communication. So even if there are two stars identical initial condition, and there is some perturbation which has caused only 100 year difference between the two civilizations, we won't be able to communicate. So even if they are there, maybe 3-4 light year away, or like Proxima Centauri B, we are supposed to have habitable life, because there is some of the planets do very interesting in a habitable zone. But the communication is very important. Rapidly the communication system is going, is changing. Very soon things are getting obsolete. So we cannot blame for us not to really be able to communicate, because we may be out of phase even by 100 years only, out of 4.7 billion years. So there could be Einsteins and Maxwells, everybody sitting there, but we won't be able to know whether they are intelligent or not, because we don't know how to communicate with them. That is a major one of the things, that communicating phase is important. If his phase is mismatched, then we do not know. But here it means a different thing. Here it means that what is the lifetime that we will remain communicative, we will remain intelligent to communicate. If you don't want to be that much intelligent, you can put a equal to one. Okay? Or all of us are communicating. So that way, if you do that, ultimately you find that almost like 1 out of 10^5 or 10^7 stars, you will find a place where there is civilized life in our own galaxy. So there will be like 10^6 to 10^7 planets where there are intelligent lives in this galaxy alone. Of course, there are many other conditions. Okay. So life in the outer world is not unlikely. By now thousands of planets have been already observed. As you know, Kepler is doing a very great job. Kepler is pointing to certain region of the sky and found several thousands of planets. And in fact, planetary, and some of them are really in habitable zone. So there is a possibility, but we do not know about of course, we will be able to maybe observe some chemicals, but whether we will be able to communicate with them is a separate story. So there are plenty of such orbits, plenty of such objects have been discovered, and you can even see that the star having three planets discovered. So like a place, solar system, of course, all of them may have plenty of planets, all of them, but we are seeing only the bigger ones because they wobble, they are causing the wobbling of the center of mass of the planet, planet and the star system. Our methodology is very much, you know, it favors only those systems with the larger or massive planets. Okay, so these are selection process. Okay, the selectively they are discovered. Otherwise, there would be much more planets. There would be much more planets. Now, many conditions have to be satisfied. First of all, as you know that the Earth, for instance, if you take the orbit is circular. Okay, this is almost circular. This is a very good, very important point, that if you have a very eccentric orbit, then whatever you make in the winter, it will be destroyed in summer. So you cannot really do a civilization with such an orbit, such a bad orbit planet. So even, and if a magnetic field is there, it helps, because it protects you from the hostile charge particles which are coming from the stellar sun, for example. So things are very right. I mean, in retrospectively, what when you see where life can settle nicely, look at Earth again, and you will see how many accidents must have taken place to protect us in this very little environment. Now, if you want to generalize, then let us say the mass of the planet. There has to be very interesting mass range. The mass should be sufficient to retain these things: carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, phosphorus. But should not be sufficient to retain hydrogen. The hydrogen should go away because it is a reducing atmosphere. You cannot do very much reactions if lots of hydrogen are there. Okay. So similarly, orbit has to be optimum. It has to be, as I said, in the habitable zone, mostly circular. It helps. Atmosphere should be sufficient so that you stop all the hostile X-rays and gamma rays to come into the planet. Liquid liquid sphere should be there, and the surface should be solid so that, you know, there is a finite region where you do the experiment. If everybody is running around everybody else, then you don't end up making very complex things. So solid surface helped. Solvents, hydrophilic, liquid water is there, generally hydrophobic is also there. And if you don't need to, probably you don't need, you can have certain kind of pure hydrophobic liquid may not be able to help you. At least not the carbon based that you see, that all the complex things that you observe with so many hydrogens and oxygen sitting around carbon and the nitrogen, of course, then I think it is very difficult. Composition and concentration, effective energy source, of course, coming from the sun. The redox potential, neither totally reducing, not totally oxidative. See, if it is a totally made up of oxygen, things will be got burnt out. So similarly, if it is totally hydrogen area, hydrogen, nothing will react anyway. So lot of things are happening there. Lot of retrospectively, you can easily see that these are the kind of chemical criteria, and the earlier was probably planetary conditions. Chemical criteria, pH range should be near neutrality, so not too much acidic, not too much alcoholic. Replication is, of course, later issue. You replicate and you sort of grow, the number grows. So there are a large number of criteria. These are, of course, you can add more, and particularly these are the things which are, but it is there. Emergence of man, it is a cognitive ability, of course, the intelligence has to be there, and of course, the manipulative capability has to be there. Therefore, you should have multicellular organism, and then only you can do manipulation. Mani has come from money, the word Latin means hands. So you want to do manipulate, if you are intelligent, you can do a lot of manipulation. Your eye can do something, your ear can do something else, all your organs are doing various things. So you can do a lot of complex things, you can be an intelligent fellow. But if you are just a monocellular or a couple of cells, I don't think you can ever be an intelligent. Now, are we alone in the universe? As I said, that there is no reason to believe that we should be alone. People are trying, not necessarily these are the best examples, but the papers came out in different journals. You see, in the meteorite itself, there are the cyanobacteria looking things, and they computed they look like bacteria fossils. In fact, when they computed the carbon abundance is much larger compared to the nearby region where they are not present. Okay, so carbon abundance tells you that okay, this has more carbon. It doesn't say that this is it is a fossil, but it says that this looks a little bit special, that object. So ultimately, as I said, that after the formation of the earth, the simple molecules must have been produced. The cells must have been produced on the surface of the ocean, and then from ocean, given enough time, the basically that 0.9 billion years, I would say plus minus 0.1 billion years, they will be taking to go from, you know, even to make a cell with a boundary which can replicate and which can break into pieces. And of course, it took another 1 billion years to produce multicellular organism. So it is a very slow process after that, but still it was done on Earth probably, and with some jump starting from some complex molecules. And of course, the what species will come out at the end depends on the mass of the planet, depends on the gravity. For example, if Jupiter were habitable, we would not be so tall. Our size would be very small because the heart has to pump a lot of blood to the brain. If, for example, even the mountains, 9 kilometers here, the moon, it is much, much higher because the gravity is weaker. From this onward, it will be dictated by the planet that is hosting the life. Okay, and Jupiter and others are gaseous, and on the other hand, the Mercury, Venus may be solid, but temperature is very high, about 800 degrees. On one side, maybe 170 degree Kelvin on the other side. So it is not possible to produce, to sustain and to propagate complex molecules in those areas. So summary, constituents of our universe is changing every moment. Life formed by numerous accidents in the vast laboratory where chemical revolutions are taking place for a long time. We are generic planet around a generic star, so not much is special astronomically. And it is likely that life is present everywhere. Conservative estimates suggest that it is about 10 to the power 7 places on our Milky Way alone. We can have lives. Thank you very much. Yes.
Any questions?
Yes.
I've got two questions based on observations of these amino acid precursors of amino acids. How stable are they once they leave this catalytic dust molecule?
No, precursors of amino acids are already so complex, you cannot produce them on the dust. Dust are good for making simple molecules, but unless you make the simple ones, you don't make the complex ones in the gas phase.
So the complex ones are forming?
Formed in the gas phase.
So then the next question was, do you think in the current capabilities of ALMA
will be going to do that. In fact, we are writing proposals there. In fact, they have already found precursors. We have written papers also. And once you find the precursors, you know that it is there. Okay. What to do with them is a different story. But because you already know that they exist in meteorites. So, but gas phase is not good to have because you never know how the meteorites were formed. So, better to see them in the gas phase so that you know directly, yes, they are formed right there.
So you talked about being able to find these acids inside of meteorites. Is it clear that the measurements that were done on those were finding what was inside the meteorites versus what perhaps they would contaminate the meteorites with?
No, many of them are not even found on Earth. First of all, you have to remember...
No, I'm not talking about that. I'm saying when they cut this thing open, right, and they measure the stuff inside, how clean is their environment that they're not contaminating the inside of the meteorite as they're examining it?
No, I think this is, of course, they have... I'll tell you the history of this. You know that both the meteorites I pointed out are 1969 meteorites, and one was discovered in February, the other was in July, and that was the year that people landed on Moon, and so the laboratories were ready to study the Moon samples. So as soon as these meteorites were found, the first thing that they tested, the laboratories were ready, and they immediately analyzed them. And they are, I hope they are professional enough, and they are taking again and again. It has been, you know, you take, okay, one slice you make, you may have contaminated, but if you go on making slices, because these are big objects, 15 kilogram or something, so you make slices and you find the same thing, I don't think that it's a matter. Yeah, it has been done in various laboratories in the entire world, totally independently. And many of them are even not found on Earth, and many of them are found on Earth. Some of them have not been identified. I mean, in space, many of them. There are glycines and alanine are the ones which have been, some people say that they are observed in the gas phase. And they are also found in the hard, in the solid phase.
Thanks for a great talk. So you said that the formation of H2, for example, and other simpler molecules which are related to the low mass of hydrogen, which sticks on these grains, and that's then the understood mechanism. So is the observed abundance of H2 very well described by this granular formation?
Yes, yes, yes.
So at which point do you cross to the gas phase formation stage? Because I've read papers, for example, on the detection of E-cyanomethanamine, which is like a dimer of hydrogen cyanide, which cannot be accounted for using equilibrium gas phase standard quantum chemical modeling. So yeah. Is this the point where
I will tell you that you know, if you take,
we're trying to look at this theory actually.
No, it will not be due to the hydrogen part at least. The hydrogen part, we know that majority, 99.9% of H2 has come from the grains.
Okay.
Only if you want to make your very complex pyridamine and even the ethylo dynamite, etc. So there, it is the pathways. Okay, the pathways which produce them will be different from in different environment, because some of them may be energetically the minimum path will be chosen. Okay, and the second aspect is this liquid phase chemistry is not understood very well, because it is in the presence of cosmic rays. And they get liquid, in fact, most of the cases we do not know the barrier potential, barrier energy. Okay, if you do two different experiments, somebody will say it is 300 degree Kelvin, somebody will say 700 degree Kelvin, even theoretically. So, to actually match with, if you match the abundance within a factor of 10, you are already in a good shape. I'm telling you, this situation is not very good. It is within 15 years, things are picking up only in a complex regime. Earlier, carbon dioxide, carbon disulfide, or acetaldehyde, or you know, or aldehydes, alcohols, these are very simple things. But as you go to complex molecules, it is not matching with many of. Let us say within a factor of 2, factor of 3, if it matches, we say that the agreement is very good. That it is that situation is like that. Our theory is not. Particularly the temperature, we may have to choose a constant temperature of 10 degree Kelvin, or you may have to evolve the temperature in a particular model, okay, which may not be happening in that particular molecular cloud, because molecular is a big and it depends on the environment. So we may have chosen a spherical symmetry, things like that, you end up with producing some amount of abundance. So we say that no, things, if it matches within a factor of 3, factor of 5, I would say that we are already in a good shape.
So,
sorry, is the assumption that amino acids and more complex molecules must form in a gas phase quite a
physical sound basis to it, or is this simply because
current
kind of quantum chemical simulations
can
only really operate?
No, you see, first of all, these meteorites that you see have collapse of the gas only. Okay. So these meteorites that you see, like a protosolar system, you start producing planets. And leftovers are produced in producing satellites, and leftovers are producing meteorites. So clearly they have to come from the gas. The temperature is so low, time took so little, that you cannot produce amino acid during the process time you are producing a 10 kilogram meteorite. Okay. So it is basically whatever matter you have, you collapse them and you produce this, or you basically stick together and produce meteorites. So the gas phase had this, otherwise you would not be having it in a meteorite. Okay. The question is, can you see them in a star forming region where the planets have not yet been formed? I am not questioning whether the solar system had it or not. It was there, otherwise you would not be producing the meteorite. And there it is totally towards the last phase of the star forming, last phase of the protostellar disk, where planets have just born and so on, the last phase. In a gas, in these regions, where you will see vast molecular cloud, tenuous, etc. The question is, can you identify them in that phase? That is the question. But otherwise, there, nobody is questioning that it was definitely in the gas phase. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to produce these amino acids, these meteorites with amino acids deep inside. These are only 10 degree Kelvin environment. Okay, how do you produce them? 10 degree Kelvin, when they got together and produce something. Okay, so you don't produce very complex reactions in a tenuous environment at 10 degree frigid condition. They are there in the gas phase. There, it was there, but we are in the last phase of the chemical. But in the, we are looking for them to find out the age of the molecular cloud. Actually, in fact, it will be. It is very helpful to produce to tell the age of the molecular clouds from the abundances. So we are trying to utilize them. There is also another exciting thing that deuterium, for example. You can also find out the, instead of hydrogen, deuterium gets in. So you have deuterated molecules, you have deuterated isotopomers. So you find out from the deuterated versus non-deuterated what is the age of this molecular cloud. So lots of other things are happening in this subject. You just substitute one by other and you try to see how long it takes to for the complete substitution, molecular abundances, mass fraction ratio, etc. It is interesting.
Any final?
Yeah. So what's the strongest evidence that our kind of biology, like water, liquid water-based, carbon-based, etc., is the one biology?
No, see, if you consider Earth, okay, even the Earth, the crust itself, one third of the crust is made up of silicon. So if you say that the Earth has so much silicon, why we are not silicon-based? Okay, the point is the silicon abundance in the universe is much, much less compared to the carbon abundance. Although their properties are very similar, carbon abundance is coming like oxygen, as you can see in the table. You know, you have hydrogen, helium, and then carbon, then oxygen, etc. So their abundance is very high. So you could produce carbon-based life. Silicon is way down. On the Earth, it happens to be sands, lot of sands around, and so you have lots of silicon oxides. But I believe that if it is produced like that, it will be carbon-based. Because silicon, first of all, silicon is very less abundant, its abundance is almost 10 times smaller. And secondly, the chemical barrier, which requires to produce them, is much larger. So once you produce them, it will become stable. But the abundance is very low, and you have to block the carbon, you have to pervert it to ensure that, no, I don't want to use carbon. Otherwise, carbon will be 10 times more around. Okay, so that is the reason. Otherwise, I think silicon is as good.
It's a question. Thank you very much, sir, for the publication. My question is about the Drake equation. With the Drake equation, basically saying there's a possibility of a parallel universe, right?
I'm sorry?
You're saying there's a possibility of a parallel universe.
No, I did not say parallel universe, but parallel civilization.
Which means there's another
We are sitting inside this universe.
Yeah, but are we saying there's another universe existing? People could say something about it might be Maxwell or how about Einstein?
No, in another planet.
Yeah.
Not another universe.
Okay.
Maybe even in Proxima Centauri sitting there.
Thank you very much. Another planet, not another universe. So my question is.
So there could be other universes also, but we don't want to. Since we won't be able to communicate with them, I'm not discussing about that at all.
We don't want to go there. Another planet. So if there's a possibility of a parallel planet that has the same entities here, how do you defer which one comes first? Like you said, like one might be 100 years light years ahead of us.
No, 100 years, not I am light years, but 100 years in terms of civilization, growth of civilization. We started on T equal to 0, and then we started growing, and then in the same way, but there could be perturbations and something passing by. And so we know that a lot of our animals got died many times over by the meteor impact, etc. So there could be small perturbations here and there. And if during that process these two parallel planetary systems are differed even by 100 years of evolution, then the communication becomes complicated. They may be, life may be equally complex, but the communication, Marconi was not born perhaps. So the point is that they are very complex, very good people, but we are not being able to communicate.
So how do you know which planet comes first? How do you know?
Do I want to know?
Yeah.
The question is, do I want to know? Because I am one out of many, and I have no reason to be special, thinking myself special. So anyone comes first is a matter of, again, these accidents. Okay, it will not help us very much in terms of understanding of the universe.
Thank you.
Well, so I think we have to stop here. Sandeep is going to be around the whole week. He's located at the visitors' room in the Max building on the ground floor. So feel free to knock on this door. Thank you.